Sophia Brueckner walked away from the job that all of my students want. She was a software engineer at Google. Now, this was more or less during the dot-com boom. My students come to me and they say they want to be a software engineer at Google, but it's the job she walked away from. Now, I'm not telling you that she's not qualified in more traditional ways, but I think if someone walks away from a job at Google in the middle of the dot-com boom, it might be one of the more interesting things about their background. She has the traditional credentials too. She's got the MFA from the Rhode Island School of Design. She has a master's degree from the MIT Media Lab. She's truly an exceptional person. She's on track to be a superstar with exhibitions, invitations all over the world. So she has the traditional credentials. The resume, it looks great, but why did she walk away from the job that all of my students want? When I think about her contribution, when I think about her portfolio of work, I think about three things. The work itself is about the future, and I think that comes with it what I would call integrity. I think that maybe she couldn't produce the kind of work she wanted to while working in Silicon Valley. What I mean by integrity, you might think about people as a futurist or someone interested in the future, as Sophia Brueckner is, and you might think of them as, I don't know, maybe even a shill for tech corporations or an advertisement. But work about the future is fundamentally about political criticism. That might not be what you think of, but let's think about the word utopia. You might not know the origins of the word, but the word itself just means an imaginary future where everything is perfect. It was coined in the 1500s by Sir Thomas More, and he was writing a book that he wanted to be political commentary, and he wanted to be political criticism, and he was afraid that the king would put him to death. And so he somehow invented the idea of speculative futures and coined the word utopia, which in Greek means nowhere, because he wanted to make it clear that he wasn't really doing political criticism, but we all know now that he was. He was imagining a future that could be. He was imagining a future. And whenever you imagine a future, whenever you say, this is how things might be better, you can't help but criticize the present. You're saying that there's something wrong now. Whether it's explicit or not, utopian work is political criticism. And Sir Thomas More knew it too. He was eventually put to death. His gambit only worked for a few years. The second word, the first word, integrity. The second word, depth. When I think about Sophia's work, I think about depth because she's an artist who engages with technology. And a lot of artists do that. And I'm not saying that somehow you have to be a technological expert to produce good art. I think that that's not the case. But there is something about having a deep engagement with the technical that produces different kinds of work. Sophia has a bachelor's degree in computer science. I already emphasized that she worked as a software engineer at Google. When she comes to the work, I think that it's clearer than it is with other artists working in the area that there's some knowledge about what goes into something like an algorithm or machine learning. So I think this depth is something that makes the portfolio better. So it's about the future, but from someone who might know something about the technologies of the future that you don't know. The third word I think of when I think of Sophia's work after depth would be scale. And that's because the depth that I mentioned before as a compliment could also be considered a negative. Sometimes people get too excited about the technical, and you see work that is a kind of kitchen sink approach where everything has to go in because they learned how to do it. And that's not what I see when I think of Sophia Brueckner. The work is brilliant in part. It succeeds because it has an intervention that it intends to make. It makes it. It succeeds. And it partly does so because it's spare. It's focused. It's pointed. I think one of the reasons the work achieves that is another facet of her background, and that's that you may have heard there's all kinds of phrases that have the word art in them, and they also have the word as. So you've heard of art as research, maybe, or art as education. And there's also attempts to combine art with other things or to shift kind of between art and design. So people who at one time might have called themselves artists, sometimes now think of themselves as designers. Maybe they even think of themselves as design scientists. And I think all of these areas have valuable contributions to make. And Sophia has dabbled in these via collaborations and other means. But I think the thing that I really love about her work that sets it apart is the sensibility of an artist. And that the sensibility is the kind that leads Sophia to stare at something for hours or days and to just say, I've got to get the sky right. I just have to get the sky right. And what is it that makes the sky right? How do you verbalize what it means for the sky to be right? You can't, maybe. It's about the craft. It's about the practice. The sky just has to be right. And it's this sensibility that I think comes from Sophia as an artist that also sets her apart from other work that might be about technology or it might be about the future. But I think it's this artist sensibility that gives the work the scale that's kind of appropriate for the intervention that is being made. To conclude, I mean, as a kind of an exercise to set myself, I tried to think, what do I think of when I think of Sophia's work? I had a thought experiment, and one of the things that always comes to mind when I think of Sophia's portfolio about technology, the future, I think about Donna Haraway. Donna Haraway, a noted scholar of science and technology studies, also a biologist, famous for commenting on the future and technology, but also a sort of an essential figure in feminist theory. And Donna Haraway wrote that, paraphrasing, that in thinking about the relationship between humans and machines, it's impossible to say who is shaping and who is shaped. And I think that's also a central question that Sophia is asking in this work. It's about the technologies that we produce and that produce us. Thank you.
Back in the mid-aughts, I graduated from Brown with a double major in applied math and computer science. I just got my first job on the other side of the country as a software engineer in the Bay Area. I loved computer science and algorithms because it was such a creative medium. I was excited to apply what I learned at school in the real world for the first time. The company that hired me was not very well known back then. That company's name was Google. Back then, it was actually pretty small, and I remember my parents were actually pretty mad at me for taking a job there instead of somewhere more reputable like Microsoft. But I thought I would get to do more interesting stuff there, and I turned out to be right about that. Google was only a few thousand employees when it started, and it grew very, very fast. That meant as a young engineer, I got to work on important things that were used by tens of millions of people per day. I'm not sure how many of you remember a time before smartphones, but back then there were no smartphones. We had those old-fashioned clamshell phones. And so, of course, there were no smartphone apps, but there were apps. People had homepages that they customized with apps similar to the ones that you have on your phone now. And that is what I worked on. I became one of the biggest homepage app developers in the world. The apps I designed and built had several million users each. The other thing about working at Google when it was smaller was that we didn't have a huge team of people handling customer support, and users wrote all of their emails about my apps to me directly. This isn't something most engineers at big companies get to experience, and it changed me forever. When I added some new useful feature, I would get hundreds, thousands of effusive emails from delighted users thanking me. It was an amazing feeling to have this sort of positive impact on so many people. But sometimes I'd be asked to do something that I knew wasn't going to go over well. I got those emails too. And while I knew that our users weren't going to like it, I was caught off guard by the intensity of their emotion. The users acted like we had betrayed them, and I would say that they even felt violated by the changes. We wanted people to put all of their information, both personal and work-related, in one place, and they did. They had structured their lives around our product, and my changes were affecting the personal and work lives of millions of people on a granular daily level. This was an extremely humbling experience. And I learned another extremely important thing at Google, that when you launch something, it is nearly impossible to undo it. Once the infrastructure is there and you have users, usually all you can do is add new features and not make any big changes to how things work. So we see the implications of this everywhere now. And I'm grateful that it is finally part of the mainstream conversation to discuss problems with how social media is structured, online advertising, data privacy, and many others. But changing how these technologies fundamentally work now that they are already so popular is really risky for a company. So risky that it seems impossible. So I ask, could we have avoided this? Could these negative consequences have been prevented or mitigated? This lack of foresight not only hurts people, it is also bad for businesses. Many of my students are hoping to go into these industries, and some of you watching might be designing new technologies yourselves. How much time have you spent considering what might happen when your ideas scale up? These days, when imagining the future of technology, I see an unhealthy inclination to cling to one of two extreme views. At one extreme, I see an attitude of blind optimism for how technology is the perfect solution to every problem. At the opposite extreme, I see an attitude of unconstructive pessimism where people can only see how technology is ruining everything, and they struggle to come up with alternatives. A good example of this type of binary thinking was in this New Yorker article written last year about Silicon Valley executives who are doomsday preppers, meaning they are literally preparing for the world to fall apart. These are the same people who are building the technologies that govern our lives, and they sincerely believe that the world might end. There was a very striking quote in this article: "My current state of mind is oscillating between optimism and sheer terror." Not only do I see people in industry either clinging to or oscillating between these extremes, I see it in the world of research and art. I see it in my students, and I see it in the attitudes of average consumers. Neither of these extreme attitudes prevented the negative consequences that we see in today's technologies. Instead, we need a different attitude. Instead of clinging to or oscillating between these extremes, I believe we need to cultivate what I would call a critically optimistic approach, a more balanced approach of earnestly proposing ideas, but not without the healthy dose of criticality needed to prevent or mitigate their misuse. So you're hopefully and constructively trying to build something, but you are also able to critique its weaknesses and consider where it might go wrong. My intention is to cultivate a critically optimistic attitude, to be hopeful with a sensitivity to the possible consequences so that you can deliberately shape the future instead of just letting it happen to you and all the others who might be affected by your choices. I'm going to tell you more about my personal story because I too was guilty of this exact sort of black and white thinking until I was forced to change. I will talk about science fiction as a way to learn extrapolative thinking, how to think about scale and consequences. And I'm going to talk to you about my projects. I will show you how I exemplify this way of thinking through my prototypes and artwork. By the time I'm done, I hope you are thinking about each small design choice you make much more carefully with an eye towards the future. So a little bit more about me. I got my first computer when I was 2. You can see me here with my Commodore 64, and I've been inseparable from computers ever since. My unconventional life path has traversed engineering, art, and design, but through it all, my relationship with technology has been more intense than most. I spent 5 years in Silicon Valley working as an engineer, but I eventually returned to graduate school to study art and design. I wanted to be the person who envisioned future technologies rather than be the person who implemented the visions of others. I then spent 7 years reflecting on technology as an artist and designer, first at the Rhode Island School of Design, and then at the MIT Media Lab. So while I was at RISD, I decided to paint all of my computers from memory. This is a painting of my Commodore 64, the computer that I got when I was 2 years old. This was my Dell Dimension Pentium 2, one of my grade school computers, which I also painted from memory. And so as I painted these, I started to notice something really funny about the way I was painting them. The paintings looked uncannily like this. If you are old enough or nerdy enough, you might recognize these as screenshots from the different rooms in Maniac Mansion, which is a classic adventure game from 1987. Now, having gotten my first computer when I was 2, I spent quite a bit of time playing games like these. My paintings looked like these games, with a strange use of perspective, an unusual level of detail to weird things like vents and windows, And I think I abstracted the views from the windows because the views from the windows in those games were already always very abstract. But they were abstract in those games because the pixels were huge back then. There was no reason I had to do this. So all these characteristics of how physical spaces were represented in these old games were showing up in the way I remembered the physical spaces around my childhood computers. We are all cyborgs, but most people just don't realize it. When I made these paintings, I saw clearly that I was a cyborg. I could not disentangle who I was from the technology that shaped me. Think about all the technologies that you grew up with and all of the ones that you use now. How have they shaped you? So while I was at RISD, I was still in my very optimistic phase, and all of my work there reflected my enthusiasm and love for technology. Like in this piece, where I sang my C++ code aloud to my computer. I'm just gonna play a little clip for you. It's actually an hour long.
Double quote OFF plot window dot H, double quote, close paren, semicolon, int main, open paren, int I equals zero, close semicolon, I less than num underscore video, OFF plot window, semicolon, I window plus, close paren, OFF setup, open GL, open paren, ampersand window, comma,
stream. So like many programmers, I know what it means to be in the zone. It's like this ecstatic flow state, a very empowered feeling, where you're so fluent in the computer programming that you can just express your intentions as code without having to translate them. It feels like the code is just flowing from your fingertips. However, to achieve this in the zone state, you have to adapt yourself to the interface and give up some of your humanness. You have to make yourself think like a computer. In this state, you can only think what the programming language allows. And this doesn't just happen with programming, which is actually a very special type of interface. More generally, user experience designers strive for this in their designs. They want you to only be aware of what you are trying to do and to forget that the interface exists. And the result of that is that you become unaware of how the interface is shaping you. In this artwork, I wrote a generative C++ program that sings its own code by mapping it to sound. I wanted to convey to a wider audience that for programmers, code is almost poetic. I carefully mapped the aesthetics of code to sounds I recorded using the built-in microphone on my computer. My iMac was my instrument. I mapped things like good use of white space, line length, and punctuation, all things that programmers really obsess over, to melody and rhythm, and this is what those mappings produced. So here I'm just going to play a 1 minute clip. As I improved the code and it became more elegant, the resulting music got better and better. There were times I wanted to stop because the sound was so good, but I had to trust that the mappings I chose would mean that the more beautiful the code, the more beautiful the sound. And that is what happened. So this piece was the pinnacle of my love affair for technology, and it exemplified how I thought programming was just so beautiful. And sometimes when I show this work, computer scientists are so moved, they come up to me and hug me and thank me because this is how they feel about their own code too. But the good times didn't last and my relationship with technology went bad. Like many, I hurt my wrists very badly by using the computer too much. I could barely use a computer for 2 entire years. This was during grad school, so it was really quite horrible. So I was unable to type at this time, and I was forced to use Drag and Dictate, a popular speech recognition program, to interact with my computer. So speech recognition is much improved now with things like Siri and Alexa, but this was the best available at the time, and the best was not good at all. So working through this software interrupted the seamless, nearly ecstatic relationship I had with computers. And at one point, I spent an hour attempting to type only a few sentences with this software, and extremely frustrated, I actually cried while the speech recognition software was still running. This text is the result of Dragon Dictate's interpretation of my crying. I used the Mac OS X screen reader to read the text aloud, resulting in this uncanny, sadly funny poem.
In the event will him, and him, and him, and him, and him, and him, and him, will, him, and him, and him, and him, and him, system, will you who are of will and the will and will the and endure it will go a little, I will.
This was a turning point in my relationship to technology. It was like I went from seeing the world through sparkly, clean, invisible glass to glass that was so filthy that all you can focus on is the dirt. Technology once seduced me into feelings of godlike, superhuman empowerment, but I became painfully aware of its controlling interfaces shaping my thoughts and behavior. I wondered how interfaces could be designed more ethically and positively, and this type of questioning has become central to both my creative work and teaching. I use science fiction, speculative design, and futurist studies to promote an ethical and extrapolative design process for building a preferred future. The deliberate exploration of what kind of futures are possible, which ones are probable, and most importantly, which futures are preferred, provides a framework to critique current technologies and to choose which possibilities we might want to prototype and test. For several years, at RISD, MIT, Brown, and now the University of Michigan, I have been teaching a class called Sci-Fi Prototyping to encourage ethical thinking in technology, and I've also facilitated numerous science fiction workshops all over the world. Specifically in my class, students build functional prototypes inspired by science fiction novels, short stories, and films. Students learn to thoughtfully critique current technological and societal trends and how to extrapolate them into the future. I'm going to just show you a tiny sample of the projects that my students have done. A human-computer interaction designer, an industrial designer, and a jewelry designer collaborated to make sensory fiction, a functional prototype inspired by the sci-fi short story, The Girl Who Was Plugged In by James Tiptree Jr. They created a book that knows where you are in the story. The book communicates with a vest that creates physical sensations on your body to go along with the story. So this could be heat, cold, vibration, or compression. This project demonstrates the possibility of a new creative medium where language is combined with physical sensations. Evan Malouf, one of my students here at Stamps, considered current trends in climate change and speculated about a future world where clean water is extremely scarce. He built a functional prototype of platform shoes that filter puddle water as you walk. My sci-fi students aren't all from heavily technical backgrounds. Alex Eason, a book artist, made a physical ebook using augmented reality. This circular book has augmented reality markers on each page, which are replaced with the pages from whatever ebook you are currently reading. So you can read ebooks but still have the experience of a beautifully crafted physical book where you can turn physical pages endlessly. My favorite sci-fi author, Ursula K. Le Guin, said that science fiction is not prescriptive, it is descriptive. Because sci-fi stories most often speculate on what people are currently fascinated with or worried about. Science fiction authors examine current trends in technology and society, and they imagine possible futures, both good and bad, if those trends continue unchecked. Another famous science fiction author, Frederick Pohl, said that a good sci-fi story predicts not just the automobile, but also the traffic jam. And maybe the car crash, which reminds me of this notorious example when automotive companies first put cloud technologies into cars. Hackers immediately were able to take control of the car through the cloud and drive it off the road. If you looked at trends in web security and just applied a little bit of extrapolative thinking, you could have prevented this. So this lack of consideration is dangerous for users, and this incident wasted company resources and undermined trust in their brand. So, if we can learn a little bit of the extrapolative way of thinking that sci-fi authors are so great at, it can give us insight into the repercussions of what happens when our technologies scale. So, taking a moment to think about scale. What happens when people go from checking social media a few times a day, like when Facebook was first created, to hundreds of times a day, which is where we are now? How does life change when you're receiving hundreds of notifications per day from various online services? Do you become like a robot just responding to instructions coming at you from afar? And is this really helping you be more efficient? What you're seeing on the screen now is a still from the science fiction TV show Black Mirror. This particular episode focused on a dystopian near future where everything is just consumed by star ratings and toxic social media. The episode itself is horrifying, but what was even more horrifying for me is that I have undergraduate students who watched this episode and genuinely believed that this future was inevitable, like that we could not avoid this horrible dystopian future. I used to think that my undergraduates would be the naively optimistic ones, but now I realize I must teach my students how to critique as well as give them a sense of hope and agency. What happens when quantified self technologies, which track your personal performance through sensors, like the Fitbit, for example, are no longer something that you choose to use, but they are instead required of you by your work, school, or even the government? This is something I've already started to see, and it is especially relevant right now during the pandemic, where we are considering different forms of contact tracing technologies. What happens when one of your five senses, like your sight, is completely mediated through the interface of one single technology? This is the ultimate vision of augmented and mixed reality. And what if what is driving all of these technologies is entirely profiting off of the collection of personal data in order to keep your attention on ads? I'm part of a very interdisciplinary artist collective called the Utopia Swim Club, and we investigate black box algorithms that govern our lives. As part of my work with Utopia Swim Club, I collected all of the advertising categories Facebook has algorithmically assigned to me. So I took these categories, which are supposed to represent me, and I reordered them into this strikingly gendered timeline that reads time, woman, infant, child, adolescence, cohabitation, career, motherhood, family, flatline. This is just a glimpse of the types of algorithmic categorizations being made about me by the many technologies that I cannot avoid. Imagine how all these technologies and their algorithms are assigning categories to you and curating your online experiences in ways that you cannot see or change. These are the questions we must ask ourselves before we even start making an idea reality, because as I said earlier, once an underlying architecture of a technology is established, it becomes extremely difficult, expensive, and risky for a company to change it. The creators of science fiction are exceptionally good at imagining these possibilities. And because of this, I like to say that reading science fiction is like ethics class for inventors. So we see the need to be able to speculate on what happens to technologies as they scale up. But what kind of speculative thinking is required? It is here that the people have this tendency to fall into two extremes, just as I once did when I first could only see the good in technology, and then once I got injured, I could only see the bad. It is true that all of these new advances in technology are incredibly exciting and inspire hope that we can make the world better. But there's a tendency to forget that technology can go wrong or be used for evil. Or we might forget to ask if a new technology is needed at all. This kind of blind optimism is sometimes called techno-solutionism, which is the idea that all problems can be solved with technology. To put that a little more simply, if you have a hammer in your hand, everything starts to look like a nail. If you're a mobile app developer, it starts to seem like every problem can be solved with a mobile app. There's this prevailing attitude that the more technology, the more data you collect, and the smarter you make your objects, that all of this will lead to more objective truths and a better and more efficient world. And if you're not already thinking about how that could go wrong, I beg you to read more science fiction. On the other hand, for many, there's a real fear that we are going to be consumed by rapidly evolving technologies that are out of our control. The danger in this is becoming so negative that you no longer can see the alternatives. I see this other extreme often manifest itself as unconstructive cynicism, or sometimes it can be a paralyzing sort of perfectionism. So if a person knows they can't build something perfect, they just don't do anything. And sometimes people try to avoid technology altogether, which is completely unrealistic. Because of my experiences, I can see both sides. I too am seduced. I too am skeptical. Interacting with technology is a cultural necessity, and our enmeshment with it is an inevitability. Looking towards the future, are we focusing on the potential horrors, or are we seeking the hopeful possibilities? This is not an either-or situation. We need more people who can operate between these two extremes, people who embody critical optimism. We need people who have enough hope to envision the possibilities for what can be built, but who also have a healthy dose of criticality such that they can see where their technologies might go wrong and attempt to either prevent or mitigate the negative consequences. I sometimes say that instead of black and white thinking, we need more medium to light gray thinking. So where are you on the spectrum from black to white? And are you where you want to be? Before she passed away, Ursula K. Le Guin said, "We need leaders who can see alternatives to how we live now, can see through our fear-stricken society and its obsessive technologies to other ways of being, and even imagine real grounds for hope." Through my own projects, I critique and prototype alternatives to the tech industry's limited visions for how we live with technology. I ask who is in power and who is vulnerable? Who is in the know and who is in the dark? How are our repeated interactions with technologies shaping our perceptions of ourselves and the people and the world around us? And most importantly, I ask, can we do things differently? I'm going to illustrate this with three of my projects, the first of which is the embody suit. Donna Haraway, the scholar who famously wrote the Cyborg Manifesto, wrote that technology is not neutral. We're inside of what we make, and it's inside of us. We're living in a world of connections, and it matters which ones get made and unmade. Technology has allowed us to connect anything with almost anything, but many of these connections are arbitrary or even exploitative. What constitutes a meaningful mapping if you can connect anything with almost anything? Thinking about this, I collaborated with fashion designer Rachel Freer to create the embody suit. The embody suit maps streams of data from the cloud to custom circuit boards that snap into your clothing to create physical sensations on the skin. This project is a reaction to the increasingly popular quantified self trend, which includes things like the Fitbit, where these technologies track your personal information for self-improvement. All of these technologies harvest data from the wearer and send it elsewhere. An ads-driven business model skews the design of technology towards capturing your attention and collecting only certain types of data that can be used to improve the targeting of ads. This is why we mostly see wearable technologies that collect data through sensors on the body. In contrast, the embody suit allows the wearer to experience data through the skin instead. One thing that shocks me when I show this project is how many times I have to assure people that there are no sensors on the garment. When people see electronics on the body, they only think of sensors, and they have trouble wrapping their mind around anything else. This demonstrates how powerful and important a single prototype can be to changing what people see as possible. This diagram shows how the wearer programs the suit to map information from the cloud to the modules, creating physical sensations on the skin. These data streams can be related to people, places, things, or other more abstract data. It is entirely up to the wearer what information is valuable to them. On the bottom of the modules are different haptic actuators. So those are things that produce physical sensations to create a gentle buzz or heat or cold. You can make other modules as long as they have the same shape. An Android app controls the modules via Bluetooth. These sensations can be constant or infrequent, subtle or jarring, singular or grouped, and they are entirely configurable by the wearer for both practical and poetic purposes. The embody suit allows knowledge to be experienced ambiently without necessitating the interpretation of symbols by the conscious mind. What I mean by that is that your mind doesn't consciously have to translate numbers into what they mean, or icons or words into what they represent. You feel a physical sensation on your skin, and your mind immediately understands what it means. A practical example is that you might program the embody suit to give you a gentle buzz on your wrist 15 minutes before it rains. This gives you a gut feeling that it's about to rain, much like how someone with an old injury might feel an ache when the pressure changes. I think of this as using technology to program a particular intuition into your body. A more poetic example, imagine that the sun shines in a place important to you from your childhood, and you feel the modules across your shoulders get warm. The embody suit ambiently connects you with a physical location that is meaningful to you. The suit empowers the wearer to reconfigure their boundaries with the people, places, and things that are important to them. I like to think of the body as an envelope, and the embody suit allows you to blur the edges of that envelope. These kinds of wearable technologies should help augment your awareness, not be aware for you. Human-computer interaction researchers Holland and Stornetta wrote a famous paper about telepresence technologies called Beyond Being There. This paper argued that we need to build technologies that improve your performance like running shoes, but that do not become a crutch. In the quantified self, data is harvested from you via sensors and then sent to be processed and monetized elsewhere with the supposed goal of maximizing your efficiency. The embody suit challenges this. The embody suit proposes a way to take back control of the configuration of our boundaries and the trajectory of our cyborg evolution. There are so many other possibilities for how we might incorporate technology into our bodies other than the quantified self model. Can we imagine a different future than what industry is presenting us with? Are we going to build crutches or are we going to build running shoes? If you could do anything, how would you configure your future cyborg self? The Empathy Box and Empathy Amulet are earlier projects that inspired much of my current research. They are devices that connect many people anonymously through the shared experience of warmth. They challenge how existing social networks are designed. So try to imagine a social network that doesn't use any names, numbers, or pictures. That's what I was trying to go for here. These projects were inspired by Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by Philip K. Dick, which is, by the way, the book Blade Runner is loosely based on. In Philip K. Dick's world, the majority of people on Earth moved to colonies far away, and there were very few people left. The people remaining were extremely isolated, and they had these devices called empathy boxes to cope with that isolation. When a person grabbed the handles of their empathy box, they would be connected with all the other people holding the handles of their empathy boxes through both physical sensations and emotions. This project, and a lot of my other work, have become disturbingly relevant during the coronavirus crisis. Philip K. Dick wrote, "An empathy box is the most personal possession you have. It's an extension of your body. It's the way you touch other humans. It's the way you stop being alone." What was really unique to me about his story was that this device connected the user with thousands of anonymous people at the same time. Way before social media, Philip K. Dick, in the late 60s actually, imagined a social network that worked completely differently than the social networks we have today. Inspired by his vision, I designed an empathy box that connects strangers through the shared experience of physical warmth. When multiple people hold the handles of their empathy boxes at the same time, the handles pulse with warmth into the palms of the hand. I also built a wearable version, the empathy amulet, that works asynchronously and more unconsciously, which also uses shared warmth. With the amulet, you feel the warmth on your chest, and it is also shared with strangers. The empathy box has handles that are made of bronze with heaters inside. I wanted the devices to look a little bit sci-fi, but in a timeless way, so I used metal and wood along with the electronics. I see these existing in people's homes as well as in public spaces, like lobbies and counseling centers, for example. The fronts of the empathy boxes are made from a reflective surface because I wanted the user to see a reflection of their chest overlaid with LEDs that represent their connection with others. When one person grabs the handle of their empathy box, the blue lights go on, signaling that it is active. Simultaneously, all the other empathy boxes begin to pulse with a soft white light at about the rate of slow breathing. This is like a call to action for other people. When one or more people join by grabbing the handles of their devices, all the handles of the empathy boxes pulse with warmth together. The empathy amulet is similar. It is made from bronze and wood, and it has a heater on the back so you feel the pulse of warmth against your chest. Like grabbing the handles of the empathy boxes, to activate the amulet, the wearer holds the ends of the amulet for a few moments of stillness and reflection on the fact that they are connected with strangers. Five LEDs on the top of the device light up one by one to mark the passage of time. After a few minutes, the amulet pulses with warmth. This warmth is shared simultaneously with one other person in the network through their amulet. Because warmth is not a disruptive signal, the receiver can choose to continue what they were currently doing, or they can stop and decide to reciprocate by sending another signal out. If the receiver doesn't reciprocate immediately, this non-intrusive ambient feeling of warmth may encourage them to do so later. I wanted the amulets to be like ripples in water, where one person taking the time to reflect makes it more likely that another will do so, and then another. Both devices incorporate reciprocity, such that comforting or helping oneself means helping someone else. Both devices take time to activate and are deliberately slower experiences that encourage reflection and focused attention. Both of these devices take advantage of how warmth is associated with human connection, but they do so in an abstract way without attempting to simulate face-to-face interaction. These devices are not meant to replace a person's interactions with people in real life, but to enhance feelings of empathy and connectedness with strangers in a way that is possible only through technology. Interfaces shape our thoughts, our perceptions, and our behavior. Knowing this, instead of just avoiding harmful designs, I ask, could we intentionally use the power of interfaces to help people feel more empowered, socially connected, and resilient? Currently, as an artist in residence at Nokia Bell Labs, I am building on these projects. Very much like the empathy box, I am working on the warming wall, which will anonymously connect incarcerated youth with people outside the detention center where they live. Instead of a social network with countless features, this project asks what is needed to communicate just presence and generosity, only presence and generosity. Recently, my research trajectory has evolved to larger scale and longer term projects, often with multiple partners across many disciplines like engineering, medicine, and biology. Every one of these projects can be traced back to one of my sci-fi inspired prototypes or artworks that served as a proof of concept. I've shown these devices in many exhibitions, both interactive and not. And while these types of devices can always be shared in exhibitions, it is not the ideal environment for people to encounter them. In exhibition settings, the user often becomes part of the spectacle, and their interaction with the device is brief and divorced from the context of the user's life. Instead, these devices are meant to be encountered in the context of people's lives and experienced over longer periods of time. I'm really interested in what it means to be an artist who deploys working devices. How can an artist do a meaningful investigation of what happens when their devices are incorporated into the messy context of people's lives? This is what I'm working on now. It's very hard, requiring a lot of different skills from different disciplines. So, just a simple example, I recently built a functional prototype and I incorporated it into my own domestic life. My internet kill switch is made with a huge 14-inch antique knife switch. It turns off both my cell phone service and internet service. Using this switch requires significant effort. Not all interactions with technology should be frictionless, which has been one of the recent goals of user experience design. Some decisions should be very deliberate and frictionful. Here is my prototype as it collides with the reality of my life. As you can see, despite my constant critique of technology, I really love technology. But knowing technology's power over me, I like making deliberate, considered choices about how I incorporate it into my life. This project is possible because I live in a 19th century farmhouse in a rural area where there is no cell or internet service without using a signal booster. While technology is central to my work, living this way allows me to reflect on my relationship with it from a distance. Being surrounded by the physical evidence of how ordinary people lived for the last 150 years gives me a palpable sense of time when I think about the future. So I've talked to you a lot about science fiction and prototyping, but now I'm going to switch gears and I'm going to talk to you about romance novels. So how did I go from science fiction to romance? I actually kept this project a secret for a long time because it seemed so random, but it turned out to not be random at all. I've read a lot of science fiction from a young age, and I still read a lot of science fiction for work. This had the unintended result of all of my dreams taking place in terrifying science fiction dystopias. I am not at all exaggerating, and it makes it really hard to sleep. So I thought I might be able to undo the damage I did to my brain by reading some huge quantity of some other genre of books that is happier and less disturbing. And after I thought about it a lot, I concluded that only the romance genre is safe. So I found all these top 100 romance novel lists on places like Goodreads and NPR, and I read hundreds of romance novels. So I just start at the top of the list and go down the list. So obviously this is kind of embarrassing. So I read them on my Kindle because I didn't want people to know what I was doing. I went into this with the same preconceptions about the romance genre that I'm sure many of you have. I thought they were trashy, cheesy, shallow, and so on. But I was really surprised by what I discovered when I started to read these things in bulk, in my case, hundreds of them at a time. If you have a Kindle, you probably have the Kindle Popular Highlights feature turned on by default. As you read, you see the passages that most people highlighted, underlined, along with the number of people who highlighted them. So as I worked my way through these top 100 lists of romance novels on my Kindle, I was very surprised by the highlights. The trick was forgetting about what she had lost and learning to go on with what she had left. So this was highlighted by 378 people. Readers were not highlighting shallow things. They were not highlighting the sexy stuff I expected based on my preconceptions of this genre. Predominantly, readers were highlighting passages that reflected their extreme grief, loneliness, and discontent with their lives. I have been collecting these highlights for 10 years, and when I look at them in aggregate, it is both striking and heartbreaking. For example, 695 people highlighted, "Loneliness could sometimes wrap itself around you so tightly you could barely breathe." This was the number of highlighters at the time I saved it into my database, and it has gone up since then because people tend to re-highlight popular highlights in agreement. The results of Kindle's popular highlight algorithm are not permanent. They change based on readers' interactions with the book and developers' adjustments to the algorithm. So I've seen some really beautiful highlights disappear since Kindle was launched because Amazon raised the threshold for what counts as a popular highlight. In this work, I memorialize these highlights onto porcelain commemorative plates. The history of commemorative plates in the United States has parallels with the recent tech and housing booms and the subsequent Great Recession. Collecting plates was really popular in the 1970s and 80s in the United States. A 1972 New York Times article titled "Decorative Plates, Not Fine Art, But They're as Good as Gold," featured people who amassed large collections of plates as a long-term investment. The plate bubble burst in the 1980s, and today these plates are worth a fraction of their original price. The article also touches on the emotions involved in collecting these plates. Many of these plates feature sentimental imagery of America's past. The article ends with a merchant saying, "What collecting does for people is to involve them in the process, give them a connection to life. There are a lot of lonely people in this country, and collecting is one way out of their problems." This wistfulness for an idealized past can also be seen in romance novels, which are often not just about romantic love, but also feature idyllic small towns, close-knit communities, and neighborly neighbors. Readers' loneliness is readily discernible in romance novels' Kindle popular highlights, and my commemorative plates capture singular moments in the evolution of Amazon's Kindle popular highlight algorithm. I pair each highlight with a hybrid landscape, which I create by running Photoshop's Photo Merge algorithm on scanned romance novel covers. Photo Merge is intended to stitch together photos into panoramas. So here, the algorithm is finding similarities in the covers and stitching them together. There are currently 16 plates in the series, and I'm just going to share a few of them with you today. This plate says, "All she wanted was to matter, to be more than an opportunity, that's all. Joy was as fleeting as a shooting star that crossed the evening sky, ready to blink out at any moment. Life continues to move forward, and so have I. Her scars were not thistles. They were velvet artwork on her heart. Defiant in the face of time, fate, death, destiny. Is it truly so unfathomable that an imperfect girl might be perfectly loved? She felt her aloneness all the way to the bone. She was alone in a way she'd never before imagined, as solitary as if she were an astronaut come untethered from the mothership, drifting unnoticed in an emptiness so vast it was beyond comprehension. So it amazes me, with all of the social networks we have, all of the social technologies, that so many people still feel this intensely lonely. Though you may call me a dreamer or a fool or any other thing, I believe that anything is possible. One whisper added to 1,000 others will become a roar of discontent. When a reader highlights a Kindle popular highlight, they are saying, yes, I agree, and they can take comfort in knowing that they are one of many feeling how they feel. This multi-year ongoing project incorporates the content of hundreds of different romance novels and currently over 80,000 individual acts of highlighting. I am always adding more. So I realize that this project isn't random at all. It's actually an existing example of an alternative social network that works completely differently than Facebook or Twitter. So I'm very critical of the current state of social media, but this glimpse of an unintentional, positive, anonymous social network emerging through this minor Kindle feature gives me hope. In this project, I draw people's attention to an existing example of collective social support and sharing to change our vision for the future of social interfaces. So in addition to collecting popular highlights, I have another weird collection. For nearly 10 years, I also have been downloading YouTube's videos of the sky by using the words sky and clouds translated into many languages. To date, I have collected hundreds of these videos. So all over the world, people seem to be captivated by the sky. They record it with their smartphones or they make time lapses. And sometimes these videos are created to be used for meditation or during prayer at church. Sometimes I think people just want to share the beauty that they see in the world with others. And then they add music often, attempting to express how they feel when they look at the sky. They upload these videos in this generous act of sharing. YouTube is a platform that is notorious for its toxic culture, but when you look at these sky videos, there are no mean comments. They're all just giving each other compliments and saying thank you, and making polite requests to use the videos themselves. The original poster often says thank you for the compliments and thanks people for reaching out for permission and says yes. And often the original poster also is eager to see what people make with their clouds. There seems to be only kindness and generosity. So during this pandemic, it seems there's a real sense of hopelessness and isolation. And so I decided that this was the right time to do something with this collection. I wrote a C++ program, an OpenGL shader, to combine these sky videos. I actually just finished this yesterday, so you are seeing a brand new work. When this program runs, it generates a collective sky synthesized from the skies captured by people all over the world. The accompanying generative soundtrack is algorithmically composed from the original soundtracks of the videos that you are seeing blended on the screen. So I'm just going to play a minute of this. This work can run forever, never producing exactly the same visuals or sound. The structure of the algorithmically generated visualization and soundtrack reflects the structure of the asynchronous online interaction between strangers engaged in this generous act of sky sharing. This is another example of a simple and beautiful social network created through the sky and clouds. Noticing these glimpses where technology facilitates beautiful interactions that wouldn't happen otherwise is hopeful and optimistic. During this unprecedented time of social distancing, we nevertheless still live under one sky, both together and apart. So here are the questions I hope you ask yourself. Do I tend to be more utopian or more dystopian? And why is that? Am I where I want to be on this spectrum? How can I cultivate a more critically optimistic attitude when thinking about the future of technology? Can I be more sensitive to noticing both positive and negative technological trends? When I am designing something, no matter how small, how can I consider what might happen when it scales up? To avoid negative consequences, should I choose one design over another? Can my design be changed slightly to mitigate possible bad effects? And finally, knowing that people tend to be very utopian or very dystopian with no in-between, that they struggle to think about scale, how can my work change what people believe is possible? I want you to remember that there are many futures possible. Don't just think about what future is probable. I want you to think beyond that and instead focus on which future is preferred. Thank you very much.